Watch Budget 2018 with Bloomberg Quint.
Good morning. You're watching Daybreak on Bloomberg Quint Live, and I'm Alex Matthew. First, let's look at the headlines. Asian markets open weak after US equities come off their peak. Low raw material prices are expected to aid Hindustan Unilever's earnings in the third quarter, while GST is expected to aid Zee Entertainment's bottom line. Lower tenancy may hurt Bharti Infratel. Those are the key earnings to watch today. The Supreme Court will begin hearing petitions challenging the validity of Aadhaar from today. And the Ruiya family comes up with a complicated holding structure in order to bid for SR Steel. That's a Bloomberg Quint exclusive. On to the international markets now, and US stocks closed lower on Tuesday, pulling back from record highs set earlier in the session as investors weighed the possibility of a government shutdown this Friday. The Dow notched its biggest one-day reversal since Feb 2016. Bloomberg's Abigail Doolittle wraps up all the U.S. market action in this report.
Earnings season for the fourth quarter continues for the big U.S. banks, and on Monday, Citigroup reported a better-than-expected quarter, causing those shares to finish modestly higher. Some of the highlights from the report included the fact that Citigroup does expect the Republican tax bill to bring its tax rate down toward 25% in 2018, but there was some near-term pain with the bank taking a $22 billion charge, in part due to the change in U.S. tax code. Looking ahead, though, the bank said today it's sticking with its multi-year plan to return $60 billion to shareholders, and that may be part of the reason that, again, the shares of Citigroup did finish modestly higher on the session. Now, on Wednesday, Goldman Sachs will report its fourth quarter, with both top and bottom line estimates representing year-over-year declines in growth. Weaker fixed income, currencies, and commodities trading may once again mute Goldman Sachs' revenue and profits picture, driving overall declines versus gains at U.S. peers as well as some of the Swiss rivals. Other issues that investors will be watching: U.S. tax reform, what are both the direct and indirect effects, plus MiFID II, the consequences, U.S. regulation, interest rate effects, Brexit, and online efforts. Lots to pay attention to there. Ahead of that report, the shares of Goldman Sachs did rise in Tuesday's Wall Street session. In New York, Abigail Doolittle, Bloomberg News.
Well, that's the word on the U.S. markets, but let's take a look at how the Asian markets are faring currently. They are trading lower, all the major ones, after Wall Street closed in negative territory. Let's go across, in fact, to Bloomberg's Rosalind Shin for all the live updates from there. Rosalind, weak cues coming from the U.S., and that's clear to see in Asia.
That's right. And Asia is following Wall Street's lead right now. MSCI Asia Pacific Index losing about just under a fifth of 1%. Japan, of course, lower as well. Nikkei trading down 0.4%. We see that that's partly because of the yen. The yen has been holding on to its gains against the dollar. Dollar, of course, story really being dollar weakness here. And we're seeing the yen currently at 110.49 to the greenback. Mostly on the topics we're seeing, it's banks and electronics makers really sort of pulling that lower right now, and all and metals are also falling, so helping to pull that a little bit lower. Now, around the region, we saw that yesterday the Hang Seng Index closed at a record high. That actually isn't going to, it looks like today it's not going to follow in yesterday to extend those leads. Right now it is actually losing 0.37%, but it's still very early in the session. It's just opened a few minutes ago, so we could see whether that rally picks up momentum. According to some, there is actually still a way to go for the Hong Kong for the Hong Kong index. There are Raymond Cheng at JP Morgan's private banking unit says the rally still has legs, and we shall see whether this is just a little blip on the way to a further gain for the Hang Seng Index. Around the region, we see the Shanghai Composite really the only major market making gains this morning. I want to have a quick look at Japan's machine orders. They were sharply higher this morning, better than expected, actually. Most analysts had expected a decline, and in fact, they rose more than 4% year on year. And we're seeing that as the economy begins to recover, that Japan's sovereign bond risk has dropped to a 9-year low. That's as perceptions of geopolitical risks with North Korea start easing easing a little bit, and of course it's a recovering economy as well. And just a quick note on cryptocurrencies. We see that Bitcoin has been falling. It fell as much as nearly 26% yesterday. Today's actually paring some of those losses. Right now it's at 11,370.83 to dollars per Bitcoin right now. We're seeing other currencies, cryptocurrencies, in a similar vein as well now, starting to make gains after falling into decline yesterday. So, of course, cryptocurrencies are very, very known for being volatile. We shall see whether that advance can be held for the rest of today. Back to you.
Thanks so much for that, Rosalind. In fact, we were just going to talk about cryptocurrencies. Thanks for bringing that up. But let's turn to Indian markets now. And Darshan Mehta and Agam Vakil are here to set us up for the day's trade and also to tell us what's happening in the futures and options space. Morning, guys. First to you, Darshan. Negative cues from overseas, very clearly.
Yeah, it is. But surprisingly, the SGX Nifty is not reacting as negatively as you know, the commodity and equity cues are. The S&P 50 is just down 4 points, but remember we had a bad day yesterday. The Nifty was held up only because of IT, otherwise it could have been much worse. Now, if you're looking at how the ADRs reacted, it was basically the IT stocks that moved up, the banks moved up, then the US, because remember it's a 2-day move that will come in, because yesterday, the day before, the US markets were shut. So ICICI and HDFC reacting positively and playing catch up. Infosys and Wipro reacted positively to the numbers that came out this thing. Tata Motors and Vedanta actually were down in trade. So that's the ADR picture that's actually come up. As far as you know, crude is concerned, it was down almost 1% yesterday. It's trading flat in today's morning, but after 5 days of rally, it is moving down. And Brent has actually slipped below the $70 barrel per mark. So there's a little bit of a slight correction that's coming in as far as crude is concerned. Now look at the commodities. Commodities are seeing selling pressure. Aluminium is down almost 2%. Copper is down almost 2%. Nickel is down close to 2.5%. Lead is down. Tin is the only one which is trading negatively. And even if you look at markets in China, look at Shanghai Copper, it's down 1.5%. Aluminium in Shanghai is down almost 1.6%. And steel is trading with a positive bias. So that's the view that's coming in. As far as China is concerned, gold is trading positively. You can see it here. The precious metals are trading with a slight positive bias. So that's the view as far as commodities are concerned. As far as fund flows are concerned, FIIs were net buyers to the tune of almost 693 crores. DII sold in almost 246 crores in the cash market. As far as the month is concerned, both of them were net buyers, almost 1700 crores of net buying by FIIs, and DIIs bought in almost 1027 crores in the cash market. Now, these were the three sectors that actually took it to the most, and these were the sectors that rallied significantly over the past 1 month. So Nifty Realty, Nifty Metal, and the Nifty PSU Bank, all of them dropping close to almost 3%. This is almost 3.5%. The big gainer yesterday was the IT pack, and it was up almost 4%. And if we see the Nifty movement as such, the Nifty was down 40 points, but just look at the contribution. 21 from Infosys, 13 from TCS, ICICI got in almost 8 HCL Tech. So majority of it coming in from ICICI Bank as well as the IT pack. And look at the contributors on the downside, the heavyweights, Reliance, ITC, HDFC, SBI. So if the IT pack didn't move yesterday a 3.5%, we would have been much more, we would be down more than 100 points on the Nifty. So this is the view that's coming in. But Agam, there could be a little bit of pressure on the put writers after yesterday's move that came out.
Certainly, Darshan, given the fact that we did see so much writing in the previous few sessions. But, you know, as Darshan's already mentioned, again, we've seen the Nifty Nifty hold on to 10,700. And that could be perhaps supposed to that the bulls took away in yesterday's GFRE despite the pressure that we saw yesterday. What happened? Very little change in open interest for the Nifty futures, Nifty bank futures as well. We saw about declines of as much as 8.5% in terms of open interest. So some longs were unwound. The VIX, of course, fell surprisingly despite the fact that we saw correction in the benchmarks by as much as 1.5% above the mark of 14. The VIX, of course, also fell in line with the Nifty, the Nifty put-call ratio for that matter, at around 1.65. Moving in terms of changes in open interest, as one might expect, we saw a little more writing in the 10,700 and the 800 calls, given the fact that we saw some correction and unwinding in the 10,500 puts. That said, there's lots of changes when it comes to, you know, F&O ban. So Balrampur Chini, Indus Cement and HCC moves into the ban. Expect restricted trade there. GMR Infra, HDL and Reliance Capital moves out of the ban. And other than that, I'm also watching out for Ajanta Pharma, which saw fresh longs. And HCL Technologies, which will announce its earnings this week, also saw fresh longs with the stock moving up by as much as 4.5%. It wasn't just HCL Technologies, it was the entire IT pack, which did very well. So we'll be watching out for those. But more importantly, the Nifty and whether or not it can hold 10,700 today.
Thanks so much for that, Agam. Let's take a check on the rupee and the bond market now. Saloni Dhanuka joins us now. Saloni, what are the updates you're picking up?
Good morning, Alex. So it was a highly volatile trade day for both currency as well as bond markets, wherein the rupee snapped its two-day winning streak and ended well above the 64 per dollar mark. Now, the rupee yesterday weakened by 55 paise or close to 1% against the dollar, thereby marking its steepest fall in nearly 8 months. Now, the home currency was pressurized after country's trade deficit widened to a three-year high on higher oil and gold imports, while strong dollar overseas also weighed on the rupee. On the global front, dollar index rose as much as 0.4% intraday, supported by weakness in euro after a report suggested that ECB is unlikely to announce plans for unwinding its bond buying program. However, remember the dollar index did ended lower, that is 0.6% lower, near 90.40 levels. Meanwhile, traders do remain cautious ahead of the release of eurozone inflation data, which is scheduled for today. While coming back home, dollar rupee is trading flat in the non-deliverable forward market, which indicates a flat opening for Indian rupee in today's trade. Now, moving on to bond market, the sell-off in bond continued after a central bank official said that they cannot repeatedly manage the interest rate risk which is given to the lenders, and hence we have seen a spike in yields, and it ended 12 basis points higher at 7.56%. While global funds increased their rupee debt holdings yesterday, they infused close to a marginal of 40 crore according to NSDL. Alex.
Thanks for that, Saloni. Let's now shift focus to the commodities market. Jayesh Khilnani joins in with all the details there. Jayesh, a bit of a sell-off in crude is a big talking point according to me.
Yes, Alex, that's right. Not a pretty picture to paint as far as all the commodities are concerned, except for gold prices, which actually surged for the fifth straight day and crossed beyond the 1340 mark. Now, you know, what has happened along with this is the volatility, the 30-day volatility has slipped to the lowest since 2010, which signals that there might be growing optimism as far as the rally in gold prices is concerned. But shifting focus to the base metal space, the index itself on the London metal exchange snapped its four-day winning streak and ended lower by about 1.5%. As far as individual base metals are concerned, nickel, which was the top loser, declined nearly 3% and saw the biggest drop since December 5th last year. On the other hand, we had copper, aluminium and lead, which also closed down more than 1% each. Now, this is all on the back of speculation that there might be more supply coming in within China. As far as Shanghai Futures Exchange is concerned, we are seeing that most of these base metals have started on a weak note, particularly copper and aluminium, which have declined as much as 1% in trade. As far as oil prices are concerned, you know, some bit of profit booking after it breached the 70 per mark, that is Brent that I'm talking about. But WTI also slipped almost 1% after five straight days of gains. Now, you know, what you can see is with this technical factor, the relative strength index that has been overbought since last week. And, you know, the chart will be there on the screen, which the bottom panel shows that the relative strength index has breached the 70 mark and has stayed above that since last week. So, you know, indicating that oil is currently overbought and may be ripe for a pullback.
Thanks so much for that, Jayesh. Now, it's going to be a busy day in terms of earnings. HUL, Zee Entertainment and Bharti Infratel all set to report their third quarter earnings today. Now, Agam Vakil, Saloni Dhanuka and Soumit Sarkar join us now to tell us what the street is expecting with regard to these companies. Busy day today, guys. Over to you.
Well, thanks for that, Alex. I'm going to start off with HUL, considering we're expecting a good quarter on the back of lower base, starting off with revenues. We're expecting about over 9% growth with respect to top lines. We're also expecting its margins to expand quite substantially to around 20%, as against 17.6%. Consequently, we could expect profits to move up by as much as 12.5% at a little over 1,167 crores. That said, what is it that's going to boost the top line? Of course, it's the volumes. We're expecting volumes growth at around 11%, but this inflated figure is on the back of the fact that we saw volumes decline by as much as 4% in the comparable quarter on account of demonetization and several other challenges with respect to the economy. And that said, we are looking at a little bit of rebalancing of trade as well after the GST implementation. So we're looking at things coming back into normalcy. And because of that, there's something that could, also bring back growth as far as the top line is concerned. In terms of margins, of course, we are expecting an expansion of well over 200 basis points for gross margins on account of softer raw materials, though we could see a quarter-on-quarter uptick, but on a year-on-year basis, there certainly is going to be an expansion, and that's also the reason why we're looking at an expansion in operating margins. What are we keeping an eye on? Well, recovery in the rural demand on the back of good monsoons, and of course, several other products that are there in the horizon. But on the whole, we're expecting a good quarter as far as HUL is concerned. Saloni, what are we expecting for Z, a good quarter too?
Absolutely, Agam. We are expecting a good quarter for Zee Entertainment on the back of recovery in ad revenue as well as on the back of a low base. Now, in terms of financials, basically, we are closely watching out for three numbers. That is, revenue, it is expected to grow nearly 7%, while EBITDA, that is the operating profit, it is expected to increase by over 10.5%. And we are seeing some margin improvement, and it will be around 32.5% for this quarter. Now, do remember, last year it was around 31.5%. While profits will be up almost 60% on a year-on-year basis to 400 crore. Now, this is, of course, on the back of a low base. Well, talking about the ad revenue, it is expected to grow in the range of 13 to 17%. Now, we are expecting a bit of a recovery here due to market share gains of Zee's flagship channel, that is Zee TV, and due to continued strength in the regional market by Zee Entertainment, while new launches in the FMCG sector, along with increasing programming hours by Zee, will add to the growth. Now, in terms of subscription, we could see a bit of a downtick due to higher base. Remember, the company sold off its 10 sports business to Sony Pictures last year, and mind you, 10 sports standalone contributed roughly 30 crore and roughly 100 crore to the ad and subscription revenue, and this, of course, will not be accounted for this quarter, and hence we are estimating a decline in subscription considering the higher base. But on a like-to-like basis, we may see a low to mid-teen growth in subscription revenue. And apart from the ad and subscription revenue, we will be looking out for the commentary by management on their plans of new launches. And also do remember that the company is on track to relaunch their OTT app, that is Z5. So any new development on that front will be keenly watched out for. Having said that, Sumit, what are you expecting from Bharti Infratel numbers?
See, Bharti Infratel on a consolidated basis is expected to report a muted set of numbers, and this will be because of lower tenancy adds in this quarter. Now, if you see the headline numbers, the revenue would grow 7% to around 3,644 crore rupees, while EBITDA would rise by around 5% to 1,578 crore rupees. Margins would, however, contract to around 43% versus 44% in the last year, while net profit would be 14% higher to around 707 crore rupees. Now, in this quarter, it will be the tower companies will be facing the consolidation heat in the telecom service provider space because of the shutdown of Reliance Communication, Aircel, Tata Teleservices. There will be a resultant in tenancy exits in this quarter. Also, Jio, which was the only source of growth for tower companies, has now slowed down and has been adding less towers. So a slow momentum from Jio will also impact the tower companies in this quarter. See, if you see the EBITDA margin numbers, the EBITDA margin will be at a 9-quarter low, and revenue, if you see on a Q-on-Q basis, is expected to fall for the first time in 11 quarters. Energy spreads is likely to decline in this quarter, and if you see, Street will be closely watching out for management commentary on outlook on the tenancy losses from exit of weaker players, and also on inorganic opportunities, like they are looking to acquire stake of Idea and Vodafone and Indus Towers. So any management commentary on this will be keenly watched out for. Along with this, management outlook on tenancy growth in context of Reliance Jio will also be a keen thing to watch out for this quarter.
Well, thanks so much for that, Soumit and Agam and Saloni, all three of you, for wrapping up the big earnings for the day. But it's also a big day in the Supreme Court today, as a 5-judge constitutional bench will begin hearing a number of petitions challenging the validity of Aadhaar. The 12-digit unique identification number backed by biometric data is being opposed by many on the grounds of security and privacy. Bloomberg Quint's Arpan Chaturvedi, who's been following all the developments in the Aadhaar case, filed this report summing up what's at stake.
Well, the first petition in this Aadhaar case was filed way back in 2012 by former High Court Judge Justice K.S. Puttaswamy, who had argued that this Aadhaar project, as it was called then, violates the right to privacy. Post that, we saw a contention being raised that there exists no fundamental right to privacy. And post that, of course, we saw a 9-judge bench being set up in context of this Aadhaar case to first decide whether there exists a fundamental right to privacy, which now, as we know, was answered in the affirmative by a 9-judge judgment saying that yes, there exists a fundamental right to privacy. Post that, the petitioner in the Aadhaar case had approached the Supreme Court again, saying that that now, since the question of fundamental right to privacy has been settled, the final hearing should begin. And then the Chief Justice had indicated that the hearing will begin on 17 Jan. And of course, after that, they also extended the various linking deadlines to 31st March 2018. And of course, that was the background of this case, in which the 5-judge constitution bench will today begin hearing the Aadhaar matter.
And sticking with the Supreme Court, the crisis in the Supreme Court seems to be far from over. Justice Chelameshwar, one of the 4 dissenting Supreme Court judges who raised a number of questions on the functioning of the top court, spoke with Bloomberg Quint yesterday, saying no solution has been found to the problem so far. The Chief Justice of India has maintained silence on the issue, but did meet with the 4 dissenting judges yesterday. Meanwhile, the Attorney General, K.K. Venugopal, has changed his stance, saying the crisis is not yet settled. Arpan, who also spoke exclusively with Justice Chelameshwar, has this report on the latest from the Supreme Court.
Well, after the 4 judges held the press conference on Friday and raised what they felt were the problems with the functioning or the administration of the Supreme Court, there has been a lot of reports, some hinting, like the Bar Council of India chairman saying that all of that has been settled and the courts are functioning properly. We saw the Attorney General also yesterday saying something to a similar effect. However, he today said that no, discussions are still ongoing. So in light of those comments, we reached out to Justice Chelameshwar asking that what is the current situation right now, and what he told us was that it's not a dispute that you need to find a settlement. His point of view is that they have raised certain problems for which solutions need to be found, and as of yet there has been no solution found. So that's what as per Justice Chelameshwar is the current situation right now.
Now, it's the 3rd IPO in less than a month in 2018. Amber Enterprises is the company we're talking about, and they're looking to raise 600 crores from the primary market. Soumit Sarkar is standing by to tell us all about Amber Enterprises and its public offer. Soumit?
So Amber Enterprises will be opening its IPO today. The company is looking to raise as much as 600 crore rupees at a price band of 855 to 859. And at the upper end of the price band, that is 859, the market capitalization of the company would be close to 2,700 crore rupees. Now, Amber Enterprises is a market leader in room air conditioner with around 55.4% market share as of 2017. Now, it serves around 8 of the top 10 air conditioning brands in India, and it has around 11 manufacturing facilities in 7 different locations. Now, if you see the peer valuation of the company, Amber does not have any peer, but it is but Dixon is the nearest one to it. But the products that Dixon offers is different to what Amber offers. Now, if you see in the P&L wise, Amber's revenue, net profit and EBITDA grew at a compounded annual growth rate of 17%, 9% and 23% over FY13 to FY17, which was at a slower rate when you compare the same with Dixon. On the balance sheet side, if you see, Amber's book value per share is around 115 rupees, while the debt to equity is 1.5 times, which is higher than that of Dixon. And however, this would come down post-listing because the company is raising around 400 crore rupees to reduce its debt. On the return ratio side, Dixon's return ratios are better than Amber. As of FY17, Amber's return on equity was 8.3%, return on capital employed was 14%, and return on asset was 2.2%. On the valuation side, the shares of Amber at the upper end are expensive when you compare the same with Dixon. The price to earnings as of for FY17 stands at around 97 times, while market capitalization to sales is 1.6 times, which is at par with Dixon. However, on PE basis, it is expensive when you compare the same with Dixon. Lastly, brokerages have a subscribe rating on this IPO because they believe that the future growth of this company is very strong because of the strong demand coming in from the air conditioning segment.
Absolutely. Thanks so much for that, Soumit. Shraddha Babla joins us now with Stocks in News. Shraddha, what are the stocks on your list today?
Well, Alex, morning. To start off with, just a quick note on what the post-market earnings were like. First, we have Jai Bharat Maruti. Decent set of numbers coming in. Revenues grew by about 13%. Net profit grew by 10%. And operationally, EBITDA was also up 11%. Margins came in unchanged at about 8.4%. But we did see a weak set of numbers coming in from Hatsun Agro Products, where revenues grew by 7%, but the net profit saw a knock of nearly 53%. Operationally, the EBITDA margins also were lower at 8.6% versus 9.8%. So we could see some negative reaction there. A decent set of numbers again from AgroTech Foods as well. Revenues grew by 3%. Net profit was up by 15%. And EBITDA margins were also steady at 8.3%. That apart, we're also watching out for Sun Pharma, which has settled a patent litigation for generic Linzess in US. Now, they've said that on the back of the settlement with the innovator, they have received a license to sell the generic version of the drug from 1st February 2031. The settlement terms, however, were not disclosed, but the stock probably will not react too much to this news. GAIL, where it has signed a pact with Gazprom for renegotiated long-term LNG supply, which will start from the second quarter of 2018. Symphony, where the company's wall-mounted air cooler has got a patent from South Africa. And separately, the company has also launched two new range of air coolers. So let's see how that stock reacts. Texmaco Rail has said that they're considering setting up a logistics hub and a food park in West Bengal. And lastly, Pioneer Distilleries, which has said that the workers at its manufacturing plant in Nanded, Maharashtra, have gone on a strike. That stock already was down about 4 or 5% yesterday, if I'm correct. But let's see if we see any additional downtick on that share today as well.
Thanks so much for that, Shraddha. Now, it's less than 15 days to Union Budget, and all of us here at least are on high alert. That one document encapsulates exactly how the government plans to finance its spending and make allocations across various categories. But how does the government earn its revenue? Here's a small budget explainer, part of a series called BQ Explains.
The Indian government, like most others, gets most of its revenues by taxing citizens, corporations, goods and services. As part of its budget presentation, the government presents a receipt budget, which lays down its source of earnings. Gross tax revenue estimates are laid out each year and a revised estimate is provided at the end of the year. In 2017-18, for instance, the government hoped to earn 19 lakh crore rupees through gross tax revenues. The gross tax revenue is made up of corporation tax, which makes up the largest chunk, followed by taxes on individuals, custom duties, excise duties, and service taxes made up the rest of the gross tax revenue last year. Starting this year, the GST, or the goods and services tax, will replace excise and service taxes. Apart from tax revenue, the government also earns revenue from a few other sources. Prominent among these are receipts in the form of dividends from public sector enterprises. Also, the government-owned banks and financial institutions and even the Reserve Bank of India pays a dividend. In tough times, you will often hear of the government seeking higher dividends from these entities. And then there are proceeds from divestment in public sector enterprises. The 72,500 crore that the government hopes to earn from divestments this year is the highest, at least since 2008-09.
There are also a few stories that you should consider reading on the website, bloombergquint.com. Here they are. The Ruya family, which owns the SR Group, may have found a way to bid for SR Steel's assets without facing any resistance from lenders or invoking a clause that requires them to first clear pending dues. Now, you can read that entire story on the website, and it's also going to be discussed in detail at 8 a.m. on First Word, so do stay tuned. Second, Deutsche Bank AG is in early talks to sell its retail operations in India. The discussions with IndusInd Bank are not exclusive and a decision isn't imminent, Bloomberg reported, quoting two people familiar with the matter. With that, it's a wrap on this edition of Daybreak, but all you need to know is up next, so do stay tuned. This is Bloomberg Quint.